Yeah, I'm going to talk about this thing, but this title is wider than what I'm actually going to talk about. I'm going to talk about this thing, actually. So spectral analysis of generalized linear models and with general Gaussian design. So this is based on joint work with Hongchang Ji at IST and also Marco, who is sitting over there, and Ramjeevan Kantaramanan at University of Cambridge. First of all, I apologize that the paper is not yet on archive, but hopefully sometime next month or something. Okay. So just to put things into context, this has been introduced several times, but let me do it again. Suppose we have some unknown parameter x star that we want to estimate, let's say in dimension d. For normalization purposes, it has norm square root d. And we don't directly observe it, observe this, of course, but we instead get a linear, linear measurement of that via some covariate vector ai. And then it's passed through certain nonlinear function q with some noise epsilon I. And this q is a bivariate function from R2 to R. And we do this for n times, and we get nyi's, so y1 from y1 to yn. And our goal is that observing these yi's and also those ai's, we want to estimate x star, OK? That's the model. This, of course, incorporates many things that you have thought about or even worked on. For example, linear regression, phase retrieval, one-bit compressed sensing. I'm specifying the function q, basically. And logistic regression. Okay, here I'm specifying the conditional law of y given the linear measurement. It's roughly the same thing if the noise is sufficiently regular. Also polynomial regression, and sometimes this generalized linear model is also known as single index model, and so on. So yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. So theoretically speaking, most people work on random design because that's easy to analyze, and also it captures certain structure of what people actually use in practice. So this includes mostly two categories of designs. One is ID, okay, I said two, but really one is a subset of the other. So one is ID Gaussian design, where AIs are just ID isotropic Gaussian with variance 1 over n. 1 over n is just for normalization purposes, not important. The other is something called bi-rotationally invariant or bi-orthogonally invariant design. If you stack those, okay, this slide is somewhat dated, but if you stack those AIs into a matrix, let's say A is with rows being AI, then this is an n by d matrix. That matrix, people assume, is bi-rotationally invariant, namely if you conjugate an n by n har matrix on the left-hand side and a d by d har matrix on the right-hand side, the law doesn't change. Or putting in other words, it's saying that the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of that matrix are independent, and the eigenvectors are completely random. They are uniform over the corresponding orthogonal group. And the eigenvalues have certain limiting law. Let's say the spectral distribution, this is just saying I put a delta mass on each singular value, and I take the average. This is the empirical distribution of the singular value. It converges to certain well-defined law. And everything in their universality class, because you would expect that even if the design is not exactly ID Gaussian or not exactly rotationally invariant, roughly the same performance is expected to be true. This has been, you know, observed in the previous talk by Rishab yesterday, and I will go back to this later. Yeah, but today I'm gonna go beyond these two things. But really, it's a modest step beyond isotropic Gaussian and birotationally invariant. I'm gonna assume it's still Gaussian, but with general covariance. Looks like a minor change, but it will mess things up a lot. So I'm gonna assume AI are ID Gaussian with covariance sigma, some general d by d matrix sigma over n. Again, over n is for normalization. So, or equivalently, you can think of that matrix A as A tilde times sigma half. A tilde itself has ID entries, but if you multiply sigma half from the right-hand side, it's making the rows correlated, but different rows are still independent. Entries within a row is correlated. Okay, why is this interesting? As I said, first of all, it's not captured by the isotropic Gaussian design or by rotational invariant design. And also, in practice, people do use some sort of covariance structure, for example, topolis or circulant matrices. for some reason in their contexts. Also, why is this non-trivial? Because first of all, as I said, it's not IID Gaussian, it's not Wigner. It's, those universality results for IID Gaussian matrices do not apply. And also, this is only left rotationally invariant because I can, you know, rotate from the left-hand side, but not from the right-hand side, because I'm not going to assume anything about sigma. Sigma can be any general covariance matrix, but A tilde itself is IID Gaussian, so I can rotate from the left, but not right. And okay, it seems that the left or right does make a difference, at least to me. For example, I don't actually know how to do right rotational invariant for what I'm going to do next. Okay. Now the problem is the following. So given that model, which generates those YIs, and also given the covariate vectors used in the GLM, I want to estimate X star using some estimator X hat. And the quality of the estimation is measured by this overlap, namely the absolute value of the cosine of the angle between X star and X hat. I want this to be as large as possible. If it's one, then they are exactly aligned. If it's zero, then they're orthogonal. You can also think of this as, you know, up to scaling or additive factors. It's basically the same as minimum as the minimum mean square error or something like that. Okay, I want to maximize this. And one important thing is that I'm going to work with proportional regime. N of N and D both go to infinity for sure, but their ratio stays roughly fixed. And they converge to some number delta between zero and infinity. So, as you will see, this is the most interesting and natural scaling for the thing I'm going to do, because at this resolution, interesting things happen. Okay, I'm gonna put some more concrete assumptions, especially on the matrix sigma. So recall this is a model, so this matrix A has rows B and AIs, and that's how Y generated in matrix form. Recall this Q is a bivariate function. When I write this, I mean you apply Q row-wise to these two vectors, these two input vectors. And I'm gonna assume sigma is unknown. So I know A, I know Y and A for sure, but I don't know sigma, so I don't know how rows of A are correlated. You will see this is the most interesting case. If it's known, it will be significantly easier and probably less interesting. And A, okay, sigma is strictly positive definitely. This may not be necessary, but okay, let's assume that. And norm is uniformly bounded, very mild. And suppose, okay, this notation, keep in mind, this is very important. This will show up frequently later. The empirical spectral distribution of sigma, namely the empirical distribution of the eigenvalue, the histogram of the eigenvalues of sigma, converges to the law of certain univariate, a certain scalar variable. Random variable sigma bar. I put a bar on top of that, meaning that it's a scalar random variable. This thing will play a crucial role. And also, let's say the prior distribution is unstructured, it's just uniform. It's an interesting question to ask what happens if the prior is structured, for example, plus minus one, or it lives in a cone or something, but we didn't look into that. It's gonna be another talk. Okay, finally, mild assumption on the noise, ignore that. So let me introduce the main character of the talk, namely spectral estimator. What is that? So given Y and A, Y is a vector we observe, and A is the matrix consisting of the covariate vectors, I can do the following. I want to construct a matrix. Let's do the following. Let's take the average of those AIs. The average of the rank one components formed by each covariate vector. This is useless because it doesn't depend on our observation. This is just covariate vectors. So let's weight them by yi. Why is this a good idea? Because yi depends on a one-dimensional linear measurement. Y is equal to a times x. So if you do this, each component is weighted by each yi. And in fact, in general, we can pick some pre-processing function. Before we put into that matrix, we can pre-process each yi by some, you know, scalar function t. For example, okay, I don't know, maybe the link function q is binary, then in that case, you want to quantize this yi. Maybe that link function is bounded, and maybe you want to truncate this yi, something like that. A priori, it's not clear what you want to do with those yi's, but in practice, people do, you know, guess some yi and do that. It seems to improve the performance a little bit. And yeah, I will quantify this thing later. So, you know, what exactly is the effect of t? And there is going to be an optimal t, which is not possible to guess. So that's the matrix I'm going to look at. As I said, so there's one hidden direction inside those yi's that depends on ai's. If the sampling, if the aspect ratio delta increases, you would expect that particular direction will contribute to a spike of this matrix d, right? So therefore, it makes sense to look at the top eigenvector of this matrix. If there's a spike, then the top eigenvector is expected to correlate it with the signal x star. And this can be easily corroborated if you compute the expectation of this matrix D, right? That's an easy computation you can do. And indeed, yeah, this is what I'm going to analyze. Look at this matrix D and look at the top eigenvector. So, okay, more specifically, why is this a good idea? I'm not saying this is the best estimator, because first of all, it's computationally simple. Just do the eigendecomposition and take the first eigenvector. And also, usually it's used as a warm start of many algorithms, for example, alternating minimization, expectation maximization, approximate message passing, gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, blah, blah, blah. So yeah, people do use this in practice because, you know, you can, it takes, you know, some extra work to analyze random initialization, as Kabir talked about in the first day. But here I'm going to focus on just this particular spectral estimator. Also, this thing per se is an interesting random matrix theory question, right? If you peel off those, you know, statistics background, I'm just giving you this matrix and I'm specifying the dependencies of those things, and I ask you, you know, what's the statistics associated with the top eigenvector? It's not actually so easy. So I'm going to assume one technical thing. Okay, first of all, t is bounded, very mild thing, and not constantly zero to exclude some trivial behavior. And I'm going to assume sup support of t is strictly positive, namely, you know, it should touch some positive number at least sometimes. So it should be something like, it can be negative, but it should touch positive real line sometimes. It cannot be purely negative, because otherwise, if it's purely negative, then the negative of that is going to be purely positive. So you would expect in that case, there would be an outlier to the left of the spectrum. In that case, maybe you want to take the bottom eigenvalue, eigenvector of the matrix, not the top eigenvector. So yeah, so this thing, yeah, I'm going to assume this. Keep in mind that t can be very negative in various sense. For example, its expectation can be extremely negative. I just want to make sure it takes some positive value. This will actually create some challenges. Okay, the main result is the following. Let for any fixed given t, function t, I'm going to define three numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2, and eta. Okay, defining certain way, I'm going to tell you later. If the following condition holds, this number, lambda 1, is larger than lambda 2, then I know three things. One, the top eigenvalue of d converges to lambda 1. The second eigenvalue of d converges to lambda 2. Third, the overlap between the first eigenvector and the signal is going to be equal to eta, I mean, all in the limit. So note that these three numbers only depend on those, you know, random variable t and delta. They are dimension independent. They don't depend on n and d. You don't have to know the data a or y to compute these predictions. Okay, so just, yeah. By the way, this condition very likely is going to be the right phase transition threshold. Namely, if this condition holds in the reverse direction, if lambda 1 is at most lambda 2, then both the first and second eigenvalue should converge to lambda 2, and eta should be equal to 0. But we don't have the proof for this thing. We won't have the supercritical behavior. Okay, so what are those lambda 1, lambda 2, and eta? Let's define a pair of random variables, g and epsilon. But by the way, when I put bar on top of a letter, it means a scalar random variable, not matrix or vector. G is this Gaussian, and epsilon is that noise. G has this particular variance just because of my normalization, so maybe don't pay attention to that thing. And y is a one-dimensional observation generated by the GLM. Okay, define A and gamma to be the solution to this pair of strange equation. Don't read this, but the qualitative feature is that this pair of equation only depends on sigma bar, T, and delta. And then define lambda 1 to be A times gamma. So OK, where does this come from? Two equations, two unknowns. I can solve this. Turns out the solution does exist and is unique. It's not so easy to show. But this thing, there are two possible interpretations of this pair of equations. One is that you should think, I mean, for those who are into random matrices, you probably recognize that this looks like the self-consistent equation for Stieltjes transforms. And yes, it is indeed the case. So you should think of lambda 1 as the inverse Stieltjes transform evaluated at A. But it's not going to be clear from my proof. I'm going to instead interpret it in the following, in a different way, subsequently. So in which this number A and gamma will pop out naturally. So yeah, let me try to do that now. Yeah, and similarly, lambda 2 and eta are going to be similar. I mean, not similar, but are going to be defined in a similarly strange way. I'm not even going to write it down. OK, so let's get some basic intuition. So this is the matrix D, just to write it down in matrix form. This A is that A, and this T is a diagonal matrix. I put T of yi onto the diagonal. So D is equal to A transpose TA, D by D matrix. You would expect that in the presence of spectral gap, then the first eigenvalue would be detached from the bulk. This is the empirical spectral distribution of D. You plot the histogram of the eigenvalues of D. In that case, whenever there is an outlier, you would expect the top eigenvector will be non-trivially correlated with X star. Namely, it has certain non-trivial angle, not 90 degree. Otherwise, you know, if this top eigenvalue collapses to the bulk, then the top eigenvector would look like a complete Gaussian, independent of the signal X star. That's our expectation, but how to quantify this? So this matrix D, if I expand A as A tilde times sigma 1 half, it's like this. It's sigma half times A tilde transpose times T times A tilde times sigma a half. T, note that it depends on A tilde because T depends on Y. Y depends on A tilde because Y is given by a certain one-dimensional measurement of the signal. So for some of you, again, who are into random matrices, it looks like separable covariance matrices, at least in shape, because over there it looks like something times a Gaussian matrix times another thing times the same Gaussian matrix times the same thing. Okay, but over there the crucial assumption is that this T does not depend on A. It's independent. So the only random thing is A hat, which is random, and both sigma a half and T are. OK, you should think of them as covariance matrix in the random matrix theory context. But here are two different things. One is that T depends on A tilde. And also, my T is not going to be PSD, because my function, calligraphic T, is not assumed to be all everywhere positive. So let's see. But you know, you can imagine these two things are intimately related. In fact, if you take out the spike from this matrix, you should be able to end up with this D hat. Let's try to quantify that thing. So this just a reminder. And then let's take out a spike. A tilde is a Gaussian matrix. In particular, I can take any direction and project A tilde along that direction and plus some orthogonal direction, right? And if I do that, the orthogonal direction can be replaced by some independent copy, just by isotropy of Gaussian. The orthogonal direction should be independent of the parallel direction. And we can do, I mean, this is, if you want to check this for G equals E1, it's just saying that I separate the first row from the rest row. And of course, I can replace the rest row by some independent copies, almost completely trivial. Let's take G to be that special vector, which is the one-dimensional measurement, right? The most natural choice. And we do we use that formula in place in D. And it looks like something times T times something. And that something is a rank one deformation of the bulk. So this is the major part, the second term. The first term, if you stare at this, is a rank one thing. So If we take out the rank one thing, we end up with D hat. It looks almost like the separable covariance matrix. And in fact, okay, there is a projection matrix, but you can basically safely ignore that. It's just projecting out one direction, but for an n by d Gaussian matrix, projecting out one direction is basically doing nothing. And you can show that the eigenvalues of d and d hat are related in the following way. Their eigenvalues are interlaced. So if you look at, for example, lambda 2, it's interlaced between lambda 1 of d hat and lambda 3 of d hat. And this thing holds for any lambda 2 to lambda d minus 1, but not for lambda 1 and lambda d. And it's not expected to be interlaced because, after all, lambda 1 and lambda d are possibly spikes, although I only care about lambda 1, right? So far we have this. We said lambda 2 is sandwiched between these two things, and actually these two things corresponds to something that looks like a separable covariance matrix. In particular, they both converge to the soup of support of the limiting spectral distribution of d hat. Whatever it is, it's actually well understood. Well, not really, because if t is positive, again, then it's exactly separable covariance matrix, then it's well understood, but here I don't assume that. And it actually takes some effort. It may be slightly more tricky than what you would expect, but the same characterization also holds if t is not PSD. You know, you take the very same formula and plug in some non-positive t, and it also holds. In particular, the conclusion is the following. So lambda 2 of d converges to the sub-support of the limiting spectral distribution, which admits certain explicit description, which I defined to be lambda 2. That's some mysterious formula I didn't show you. But it's some explicit thing, depending only on these three objects. OK, so far we have the bulk. So we are basically halfway through it. We showed equation number 2 in the main result. But what about 1 and 3? Okay, for this, I'm gonna do something completely different. Suppose you don't know anything about random matrices or whatever. I give you some matrix, and I want you to compute the top eigenvector or top eigenvalue. What would you do? The first thing might be power iteration. You take that matrix D, I expand it as this. You use it to hit iterate VT and normalize it so that it has unit norm. And you do this for multiple steps, and you would hope that whenever there exists a certain spectral gap, it should converge to the top eigenvector. That's, you know, what we learned from undergrad linear algebra. What I'm actually going to do is not exactly power iteration. It looks something much more complicated. So let's unpack this. So okay, first of all, note that there is a pair of iterates, U and V. This is because my matrix A tilde is rectangular. It's n by d. So I have to jump between n-dimensional iterate and d-dimensional iterate. So they are a pair of iterates. If you ignore that negative part, then basically it's A tilde times U tilde or V tilde, where U and V are non-linear functions of V and U and V. Sorry, U tilde and V tilde are non-linear functions of U and V. So this is basically non-linear power iteration, right? I allow you to do some non-linear transformation f and g, but up to that it's just a generalized power iteration. What makes this algorithm an AMP, approximate message passing, is the existence of these two terms, these negative terms. They are memory terms, and the Onsager coefficients, BT and CT, are very carefully chosen. They depend on the derivative of the functions f and g. Not clear why this takes this shape, but let's take this for granted. So only in this shape it's called approximate message passing, OK? Okay, also note that I'm doing this iteration on top of A tilde, not this original matrix D, because AMP can only run on simple matrices. A tilde is IID Gaussian. So to specify an AMP, I just need to specify F and G, or FT and GT. Okay, I want to use this to simulate power iteration. Okay, this is a typo, so it should be lambda V. Left-hand side should be lambda V equals D times V, so this is the eigen equation corresponding to the matrix D, right? But on the other hand, my GAMP, my generalized approximate message passing, looks like this, right? I want to use this to simulate that eigen equation. How can I do this? It comes down to choose f and g, right? Suppose t is sufficiently large so that everything converges, so I remove the time indices heuristically. Now let's choose f and g in the following way. I'm throwing this right to you, but There's a way to reverse engineer this thing, but I'm telling you that you should choose F to be some matrix depending on sigma times V, and G to be some other matrix depending on T times U. And those matrices, there are two undetermined parameters, A and gamma. Note that if you fix F and G, B and C are fixed. They are given by Onsager coefficients, so there is no choice. So I need to tell you what is A and what is gamma. So you can, you know, scale A and gamma so that some nice things happen. These choices are somewhat arbitrary, but I choose it to simplify our derivation. So let's say I choose A and gamma so that B, this B, is equal to 1, just for simplicity. And that thing, this normalized norm squared is equal to 1. This makes sense because I want to make sure my iterates are bounded, something like that. So these are a pair of equations. I can solve A and gamma from here. Well, not really, because it depends on D. But I claim that these quantities can be computed from state evolution. So ultimately, you will get a pair of equations. And that pair of equations is exactly the same as the strange equation I showed you some slides ago. So if I choose this, you can plug it in and see what happens. Indeed, nice things happen. Do some manipulation. You end up with this. Let's stare at this for a moment. You realize that this looks like some number times some vector equals d times the same vector. So it looks exactly like it looks exactly like an eigenequation. And we even know what the eigenvalues are. The eigenvalue is going to be a gamma. And this is what I'm going to call lambda 1. And the eigenvector is supposed to be that thing, sigma minus a half times f of v. OK. So the only mysterious thing I did is to give you this f and g. But I claim there's a way to guess it. All of these are heuristic, but let's try to quantify this. So to quantify this, I need state evolution. I don't think it has been introduced by now. But let's define random vectors, capital Vt in dimension d, as the mixture of, as the sum of some component along this, you know, non-isotropic signal, plus some independent Gaussian noise. So this Wt is independent of f star, and Wt is a Gaussian. And in fact, if you collect those W1 to Wt, they are jointly Gaussian. And their covariance structure is given by this T by T matrix sigma psi T. Note that I have T d-dimensional Gaussian vectors, but I only need T squared number of numbers to describe their joint correlation, because those Gaussians are isotropic, so I don't need, you know, naively I need T times D by T times D a matrix, but here I only have this psi T, and then it's tensored with ID. So they have very succinct representation. More nicely, this psi T can be computed recursively. I don't write down the formula because it's messy, but trust me that if I specify the function f and g, you can compute these psi T recursively from previous psi T minus 1. And similar things holds for chi T. OK, so then what is this vector? I claim that these are very accurate description of the iterate Vt in high dimensions. In particular, if you do this, they pass any pseudo-Lipschitz tests. So basically, you can safely replace small Vt by capital Vt in your calculation. The nice thing is that capital Vt looks like a Gaussian. I mean, something plus a Gaussian, whose covariance you know. This is not at all clear for power iteration. In fact, it's false for power iteration, but it's true for GAMP. OK, let's try to get to the crux of the argument. So I said the AMP equation looks like a power iteration. It, indeed, by some manipulation, it looks like this. It looks like Vt plus 1 equals d over a gamma times Vt plus some error vector. Supposedly, it should be small. And indeed, it's going to be small if t grows. Let's ignore that. So this is exactly power iteration, right? Let's do some trivial thing. Run this for another t prime steps. Take the norm on both sides. Take spectral decomposition on the right-hand side. You get these terms. I separate the first term from the rest for a good reason. So you have these terms looks like, you know, lambda 1 of d over a gamma to the power of 2t prime times the overlap between vt and my eigenvector, the corresponding eigenvector. Now take the limit. And if, I mean, I told you that lambda 2 converges to lambda 2 of d converges to lambda 2. This is known. I just showed you. if it happens that this number lambda 2 is less than a gamma, which I define to be a lambda 1, then those things will all vanish. Because lambda 2 is less than a gamma, it decays geometrically. So lambda 3 is also less than a gamma, because I, you know, they are in decreasing order. All of these vanish. I end up with this. Let's stare at this equation. I claim the left-hand side can be computed using state evolution. After all, you know, it's something related to the you can replace this VT plus T prime by capital VT plus T prime, but it's a Gaussian, so we can compute it. Now, let's say it's equal to nu squared. Now, staring at this equation, you cannot exchange the limit. It's important that you do sequential limits. Which goes to zero? These terms, right?
Yeah, exactly.
This is okay because this is true for any t. For fixed any t, this term is bounded. This is at most one. This is at most some constant.
Yeah.
So this is bounded. For any t, if lambda 2 converges to something less than a gamma, as d goes to infinity, there's no t here. As d goes to infinity, as d goes to infinity, if lambda 2 of... Yeah, one has to be a bit careful with the limits, but I'm kind of going fast with it. Okay. Yeah, we are here. So we are at this equation. So left-hand side is some given number, is some number computed from state evolution. Right inside is this. It has to be the case, you know, staring at this, it has to be the case that lambda 1 converges to a gamma. Why is that? If it converges to something larger, right inside blows up. If it converges to something smaller, right inside converges to 0, which violates this identity. So it has to be the case the limit of lambda 1 of d is equal to a gamma, and vt and V1 of t are aligned, okay, just by staring at this equation. So basically, we're done, right? We said, you know, I give you the limit of lambda 1 of t, and we have this. Why we're done? Because I can now compute overlap between eigenvector and x star by replacing eigenvector by my iterate. But my iterate, I have a good control. I know it's going to be a Gaussian. Compute that, you get some formula. It's called eta. And it happens to be strictly positive whenever this condition holds. Okay? Okay, that's it. I guess I'm gonna, let's briefly talk about it. It makes sense, you know, this condition, roughly speaking, says that if the sampling ratio is sufficiently high, then I have correlation. You can think of this heuristically as delta larger than some threshold. Therefore, I can try to choose my t. I didn't tell you what t is, because this is true for any t, but I can choose my t to minimize this threshold. This means that I can, you know, it's easiest for me to get positive overlap. It turns out this delta star is given by this complicated thing, whatever it is, and the best t star is given by this. This actually, first of all, okay, there is no way to guess this. Also, this happens to match some physics prediction from this pair of paper by Maillard et al. From EPFL, using heuristic calculations, but for more general right rotationally invariant ensemble. But note that here, my matrix is not right rotationally invariant, it's left rotationally invariant, but somehow we get exactly the same formula, which is, I found this amusing, and this is probably suggesting some miraculous universality behavior, which I don't understand. And it seems that the universality results, which Rishabh talked about yesterday, does not really cover this case, because, you know, left and right does seem to make a difference. Okay. And yeah, this t, okay. As we saw this, okay, qualitatively, this formula depends on these kind of quantities, depending on the link function. These things are actually the Hermite coefficients of the link function. sigma 0 and sigma 2. So if the second Hermite coefficient of the link function vanishes, then the spectral threshold blows up. It means that a spectral threshold, you know, spectral estimator is going to be ineffective, no matter how large delta is. This makes sense in hindsight because, you know, there's a line of work understanding information exponent introduced by Reza and his collaborators. You know, he's somewhere in the audience. By Benarus, Reza, and Jagannath, information exponent is the order of the first non-vanishing Hermite coefficient of the link function. Here, we only look at information exponent 2, and we say that, you know, whenever it's finite, then we're good. Whenever it's infinite, then we're not good. So we can think of this as a small facet of that phenomenon. There's a generalization of leap complexity, which I think Enric is going to talk about right after this. So I'm not going to get into that. Let me skip this. It's not important. I said that we only have supercritical behavior, namely, whenever lambda 1 is larger than lambda 2, we have characterization for everything, but not the other way around. Of course, we would expect the other way around, things would not work, but we don't have a proof. And get back to the title. I only analyzed this particular generalized linear model, but the very same methodology should or is expected to work for many other contexts. Let's say you give me some natural random matrices arising from some statistical contexts. Chances are that I can analyze that using this methodology, and indeed we have already worked out some things which are, you know, still in writing. Also, I mentioned this miraculous coincidence with the physics prediction for right rotationally invariant ensemble, which is strange because they. My ensemble is not right rotationally invariant, so universality is something going on. Also, I only talked about spectral estimator. I don't claim it's a good estimator. It's something that people use, but it's not the best thing in the world. The best thing in the world is MMSE is base optimal estimator. You know, conditional expectation of x given y and a. That actually has been analyzed in the same paper, and I think just for that part, it's actually rigorous. It's rigorously known that the MMSE for this model with left rotationally invariant ensemble is known. Now the question is, you know, how spectral estimator compares to that limit, and is it base optimal? Is it information theoretically optimal? If yes, that's interesting because spectral is good. If not, also interesting, it's probably suggesting a information computation gap, and how to mitigate that, how to show hardness, I don't know, and I leave it to the audience, there are experts. So yeah, that's it. Thank you very much. So yeah, everywhere in that paper except this MMSE is about right rotationally invariant, general right rotationally invariant, not necessarily Gaussian times something, just general. But just for this part, they look at some Gaussian times arbitrary matrix, and which is, our model is a special case of that. And just for that part, the result seems to be rigorous using, you know, your adaptive interpolation method. And they have a formula. I don't know how that compares to, for example, my eta, and how the threshold compares to my threshold.
But you don't know because you didn't do it?
Or? I didn't do it. It's known, yeah. Sigma is identity, then this is well understood. Actually, both sides are well understood. If you're above the threshold, it's known. Below the threshold, it's known to be zero. So we have a full phase transition. Yeah. Yeah. So could you speak a bit louder? Okay, it goes, yeah. The random matrix theory part, you can probably do it because there are much more, you know, there are microscopic description of those things if you want to do the math. AMP part is gonna be much more technical. There are recent work analyzing non-asymptotic behavior of AMP, but only in the context of rank one matrix estimation. It's potentially generalizable, but it takes a lot of work. But in the best case, I don't expect it to give the negative side of the phase transition. I don't think that can be done. Yeah. I mean, I don't think it can be done using purely AMP. You can probably do it using RMT. That's the right way to go. But it's gonna be challenging. I asked some experts in RMT, but it doesn't seem to be easy. Yes. Right.
So can we correct the bias or should we?
Actually, that's not the bias, that's the good thing, that's the signal. So it has some component along the signal plus some noise. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, sorry, one more question.
Sure.
Does the non-linearity of link function Q affect this result?
Yes, as I mentioned, okay, so I change notation sometimes. The Q can also be thought of as the conditional law. So this Q of G epsilon can also be E of y given g, something like that. So sometimes use this, sometimes use that. And you see in the result, this shows up. If you think of this as a function for any given y, you think of this as a function of the second component. And you look at the Hermite coefficients, this thing shows up in the result. So yeah, in this form. Yeah. I would say pretty crucial. It's used in AMP, and if you change that, I mean, you don't expect the same thing holds because if you change to async prior, for example, you may observe some information computation gap or something, I would expect. So yeah, the threshold would change,
yeah,
I think. It can be done, but I didn't do it. Yeah. Yeah, but on the other hand, spectral estimator is, you know, doesn't care about prior, so it may not be a good idea in the first place to use spectral estimator because it's just eigenvector. There's no a priori any structure.
Yeah, that's true. They may
be a prior that you just don't know. Yeah, okay, sure. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.